Hello learners, I am Professor Neeraj Dilbagi, Department of Bio and Nanotechnology, Guru Jambeshwar University of Science and Technology, Hisar. This is the part 1 of module Protein Engineering or Enzyme Engineering. In this part, we will cover basics, objectives and methods of protein engineering. The steps involved to engineer a protein will be discussed in detail. Apart from the reasons why one want to engineer a protein or an enzyme. Towards the end, we will also discuss the limitations of protein engineering. In the part 2, we will talk about applications of protein engineering in food industry. This module is part of syllabi of MSc Microbiology, Food Microbiology course of 4 semester, and also for students of MSc Biotechnology who have opted for Food Biotechnology course in the 4th semester. Now, let me start with what is protein engineering, that is the introductory part. Basically, protein engineering is a very young discipline that has been branched out from the field of genetic engineering. It is based on the available knowledge about protein structure, functions, tools and instrumentation, software and bioinformatic databases, available clone genes, knowledge about available proteins, vectors, recombinant strains and other materials that could lead to change in the protein backbone. In simple sense, I can say that protein can be modified through its gene or it can be modified using chemical method. So if I sum up in the form of a definition, protein engineering is a multidisciplinary approach that involves computer-aided molecular modeling based on the study of three-dimensional structure of receptor and functional. It can be defined as the use of genetic and chemical techniques to change the structure and function of a protein, thus resulting in a modified product with specific desired property. Or in simple sense, it is a technique to make superior enzymes or superior proteins. Basically, protein engineering is not a subject, it is a discipline where understanding of various areas like molecular biology, protein chemistry, structural chemistry and enzyme is essential. All in these knowledge are required, then only you can engineer a protein. So let us talk about what is the basic reason or background. I will just within 5 minutes tell you the protein gist. You know, proteins are made up of 20 different type of amino acids. They are joined together in a linear order. This sequence of amino acid is the primary structure. The primary sequence forms the secondary structures. The secondary structure forms the tertiary structure. And these proteins play different roles in life. They act as number one, structural proteins. That is the organism's basic building blocks. For example, your hair, nail, collagen, etc. Proteins also act as transmembrane proteins. That is, they are cells' housekeepers, which regulate cell volume or perform different function like your muscle function, nerve cell function, etc. Also, proteins act as enzymes. All enzymes are proteins except ribozymes. These are biological engines which mediate multitude of biochemical reactions. If we talk about enzymes, they are widely used in food industry. to control the texture, appearance, flavor, and nutritive value of processed foods. The food processing industry is the single largest user of enzymes, accounting for on an average more than 50% of the enzyme sales. So in a simple sense, I can say that majority of enzymes, that is more than 50% of the total enzymes which are produced worldwide, they are consumed in food industry. If you look at the applications of enzymes in food processing, this table will tell you some of the important things. There are large number of applications of protein engineering in food industry or enzyme industry in food industry. Different enzymes like alpha amylase, cellulase, glucoamylase, glucose isomerase, etc., they are used in food industry for different functions. For example, alpha amylase is used in brewing and baking. Cellulase is used for juice clarification. Similarly, lipase is another major enzyme which is used for cheese ripening. Pectinase is used in wine and juice clarification. Proteinases, different types, they are used for beer haze removal or haziness of beer, turbidity of beer, dough conditioning, meat tenderization, and the one of the most important among these is D-glucose isomerase, which is used for production of high fructose corn syrup. In fact, I will be talking about example in the second module, because this was the first candidate which was modified. Then there are other examples also. People are trying to engineer the wheat gluten proteins. Wild type and mutants have been developed. You know, people these days talk about gluten-free products because there is a lot of allergy by gluten proteins. So this is one of the another important candidate where modification has been sought. Some large group of enzymes like these proteases, similarly amylases, and similarly lipases, they are important for both food and detergent industry, and they have broad range of applications. Similarly, proteases are widely used, different type of proteases, they are widely used in food industry regarding low allergic infant formulas. Similarly, they are also used to control flavors, milk clotting, etc. So these are important candidates. The improvement of protease in the industry is very important. For example, high activity at alkaline pH is desirable. High activity at low temperature is desirable. Improved stability at high temperature is desirable. So these are challenges or areas where protein engineering can be done. Actually, if you recall what you have studied in your last semester course is that enzymes have an optimal pH, optimal temperature. They require optimal substrate concentration for their activity. And on both sides, means if the temperature is decreased or increased, if the pH is decreased or increased, or substrate concentration is decreased or increased, there is sharp decline in enzyme activity. So in food industry, we are using these enzymes for different type of operation, all these operations, but they are used in food industry at pH, temperature, and other concentration which are far beyond their optimal level. It means that the process which is used in food industry is not the one which is optimal for enzyme activity. So we require modification of the activity of enzyme as far as their pH optima is concerned, temperature optima is concerned, substrate optima is concerned. For example, I have talked about lipases from Bacillus and Candida. They are used in cheese industry. They are used in food industry for many other applications, such as for stability and conditioning of dough as emulsifier and for development of cheese flavor. Lipases are also crucial for detergent industry. and they are used to remove various type of stains related with lipids or oily stains. So it means that they are again a very important candidate for food. Now there are certain reasons why we are interested in protein engineering. The first and foremost is to bring change in the catalytic property by either increase in Vmax or decrease in Km. You know what is Km? It is the substrate concentration at which the velocity of enzyme catalyzed reaction is half of Vmax. Similarly, we want to change the catalytic property of enzyme, that is, we want to change the pH optima, because in food industry, maybe the process is working at 7 pH and enzyme activity is optimal at 6 pH. So we want to change the optima, so we want to engineer the protein. How engineering is done? By genetic engineering. And how genetic engineering is performed? The idea is to change or make changes in the primary sequence of gene corresponding to the protein function, or gene sequence is altered with respect to active site if we want to change the substrate specificity. Similarly, alteration of specificity of reaction if you want to change the reaction specificity. Similarly, to bring about changes in catalytic properties by elimination of a residue that confer instability. Suppose there is a site where inhibitor binds and it decreases the rate of reaction. So we can confer stability by so that the inhibitor does not bind. We can modify. Second is to bring about changes in structural property of the enzyme. How we can do this? So that we can increase the thermostability by improving the stability in organic solvents. Changes in physicochemical properties or modifications of ligand binding specificity. And the third reason why one might want to engineer a protein is creation of a new system by chimeric or multifunctional proteins, addition of tags for purification so that we can monitor the purification of enzyme, improvement of effectiveness of therapeutic agents. This is especially useful in drug industry, because protein engineering is also used for drug designing also. Now, what are the important applications of protein engineering? Number one is to produce enzymes for large scale use in chemical and food industry. Number two, to create superior enzymes to catalyze production of high value specific chemicals. Number three, to produce biological compounds that are superior to natural ones, such as storage proteins, synthetic peptides, etc. Number four, producing an enzyme with altered pH activity profile, thus allowing to enzyme to function at non-physiological pH. So we want to change the pH or temperature or specificity. And the last is to design enzyme resistant to proteolytic degradation. So these are some of the application means areas what we can target, why we want to modify or carry out enzyme. Now let us try to understand what are the steps involved in protein engineering. But one thing I would like to make you clear beforehand. Actually, you have heard about site-directed mutagenesis. So we are going to carry out site-directed mutagenesis in the primary sequence of gene comprising that enzyme, which is responsible for the desired functionality. I think you are clear with it. Suppose you want to alter the substrate specificity, or suppose you want to alter the thermostability, then you will target those particular amino acid sequence or the genes in the primary sequence which correspond to the prime sequence of amino acid you wish to change. So it means you will carry out site-directed mutagenesis, means by addition of base pair, or by deletion, or by substitution. So you will carry out amino acid substitution, or amino acid addition, or amino acid deletion. There are few assumptions. Many amino acid substitution, deletions or addition lead to no change. It means you have to carry out 10 times. Maybe you may not get the desired results. So these type of mutations are known as silent mutations. Similarly, you know, proteins have a limited number of basic structures and only minor changes are superimposed on them, leading to variation. And similarly, the patterns of chain folding and domain structure can arise from different amino acid sequence, which show little or no homology. So what I want to say is that the properties I have discussed, these suggest that while many minor changes bring no alteration in the function, few minor changes at specific position can bring desired favorable changes. So it means you have to work on different permutation and combination, and that is why you are using computer aided molecular modeling software, because you cannot carry out large number of experiments. So you use softwares which will suggest you few of them, and those modification you will try by site directed mutagenesis or by gene cloning, and then you will get the desired results. So let us try to understand what are the steps involved in protein engineering and design cycle. First of all, protein sample is prepared from an organism and it is characterized, assayed with respect to ligand. For example, antigen antibody complex, hormone receptor complex, or we can say enzyme substrate complex. This is the first step. That is, you have to carry out preparatory biochemistry and characterization with respect to ligand. Second is, the three-dimensional structure of the protein is studied. How you will study it? You will carry out either XRD or you will carry out go for NMR. If your protein is crystalline in nature, then you will go for X-ray diffraction, XRD analysis. And if your protein is in solution form, then you will go for NMR. But in all cases, NMR is better, because for XRD analysis, three-dimensional structure determination using XRD, you require one additional step to make the protein crystalline. The three-dimensional structure of the protein, which is then displayed with an interactive computer-aided molecular modeling software or computer graphics software. And this software will suggest a novel design which will suit it to our needs. So software will do everything. It will suggest a design that now you carry out modification at this level. Then the desired sequence that is expected to give the novel design protein is either synthesized, you can synthesize it, or obtained by site-directed mutagenesis. Both way you can do. The novel gene is then introduced into expression vector and cloning is performed, and the gene product is finally purified, and this purified gene product is characterized biochemically, and finally we get the expression. Based on the expression, we will know that what is the end result. If this biochemical characterization does not satisfy the early predicted structure, then this entire cycle is repeated. It's not always that you get a desired result. Suppose you have proposed a graphic design, knowledge-based design using a 3D software. It's not essential that it will always work. You have to carry out many times. Had it worked every time, then large number of engineered proteins, they would exist in the market. Now, let us try to understand this entire sequence or steps which are involved in protein engineering. We can split them into three protein structures. First is this part, up to this part, from preparatory biochemistry to elucidation of 3D protein structure. Means first we want to know what is the 3D structure of the protein. Okay, Once we know the 3D structure, the second part is protein modeling. Okay, whatever data we get from NMR or XRD, that we will carry out modeling using these type of software. And the last is perturbation theory, that is what novel design will be suggested, that we'll try to perform. And NMR data, this is used to study the three-dimensional structure of protein, including the active site. Both XRD and NMR allows us to generate data at fast rate so that we can predict the 3D structure of proteins. NMR is used when protein exists in solution form rather than solid form. So the main drawback of XRD can be bypassed, that is a time-consuming step of crystallization, which is required for study of three-dimensional structure using X-ray diffraction, is not there in NMR. Based on these two techniques, the 3D structure is elusive, and this 3D structure data obtained from NMR or XRD, it can be constructed with the help of computer graphic softwares. These are interactive color graphic programs with the help of which a protein structure can be fitted on the screen of a computer monitor. Once we have the structure, then perturbation theory is formulated, which will enable us to calculate the effect of small change in amino acid sequence accurately. So with this type of theory, there will be no need to perform experiment at each step. It is actually prediction. Perturbation means prediction. We can predict that what changes will be done in amino acid, what will be the result of that, suggested modification and the outcome. Okay. Now, what are the methods which are available to selectively mutate DNA? There are four methods of protein engineering which are commonly used. These are the methods which are most important, but the best part is that what we have to do in all these methods, whether it is oligonucleotide based site directed mutagenesis, where we use synthetic oligonucleotide, or cassette mutagenesis, or in vitro chemical mutagenesis, and the fourth one, which is PCR based mutagenesis, our objective is same, that is we have to undergo or we have to go for in vitro mutagenesis. When genetic engineering was not there, people used various mutagenic agents like chemicals, UV radiation, gamma radiation, etc. to mutate or to carry out spontaneous mutation, and then they characterized it phenotypically followed by genetic analysis. So these type of techniques were used before the advent of gene cloning. But modern method of in vitro DNA manipulations, they have considerably broadened the scope of mutagenesis by allowing the construction of specific alternation. We can compare some of these techniques. So if somebody asks you in exam what are the methods used for protein engineering, you have to talk about all these four methods. And apart from these four methods, two recent techniques also I will be discussing later on. So this first technique is oligonucleotide based site directed mutagenesis. Here we use synthetic oligonucleotides. You can see from the diagram, this method actually requires synthesis of a very short 15 to 20 base pair oligonucleotide, which are complementary to the sequence of gene around the site to be mutated. But this contain one mismatch. Here one mismatch is there. At the base we wish to mutate. Okay. Second part is this single stranded clone of complementary strand of enzyme molecule. Single stranded clone of enzyme molecule is taken in a M13 phage vector. This single-stranded DNA this M13 phage vectors, this single-stranded DNA is mixed with it. Mixing is done at low temperature in the presence of high salt concentration. This mismatch will anneal hair. After annealing is done, this mismatch will hybridize to the appropriate position of the enzyme gene. It will hybridize. Now DNA polymerase enzyme is used and it will carry out extension. The remaining complementary strand of DNA is synthesized. Towards the end, ligation is performed, and after ligation, transformation is done into E. coli. The DNA ligase join the ends of the synthesized, newly synthesized DNA to oligonucleotide primer. The double-stranded DNA molecule is then introduced into E. coli, and replication of E. coli will result in either wild type or mutated enzyme sequence. The transformed cells are differentiated from the non-transformed cells by plating out and observing the formation of inhibition flaps by the transformed cells. And this method can be used to introduce deletion or insertion of sequence. Sequence type or methods is very simple, but requires screening and selection of large number of mutants. So it is a very cumbersome approach. Second method is Cassett mutagenesis. Cassett, as the name indicates, this method is used when sequence of gene to be mutated. This is a sequence of gene to be mutated. Lies between two closely spaced unique restriction enzyme cleavage sites. The intervening sequence, this is a mutated region. So there are two sites here which are unique restriction site. This intervening sequence is excised and replaced by chemically synthesized oligonucleotide. What we have done, we have carried out restriction, used two restriction enzyme. This cassette has been removed. The mutated cassette containing the desired mutant gene is mixed, and now it will bind the oligonucleotide containing a mixture of substitution at a particular site can be used to generate a large family of mutant enzyme with different replacements at particular codon. Basically, this method is very convenient, but require unique, conveniently placed restriction site. Otherwise, if two unique restriction sites are not there, this method won't work. So it is a kind of cassette, means the normal one is replaced by a mutated version. The main application has been for local random mutation, where one or two amino acids are exchanged by possible replacement. Third is in vitro chemical mutagenesis. As the name indicates, you have to treat with different chemicals. The chemical mutation modification is the most optimum for random mutagenesis. So chemical can react at any place on the DNA, so it will result in random mutation. For instance, the transition of a cytosine to thymine by treatment of single-stranded DNA with sodium bisulfite. So it means if you treat a single-stranded DNA by sodium bisulfite, cytosine will be replaced by thymine. Targeting of the mutation is achieved by various procedures based on localized exposition. You have to expose the local area which you wish to mutate of single-stranded DNA with a double-stranded DNA. But the procedure is usually cumbersome, and the control of distribution and efficiency of mutation is deep. There are some examples where people have tried to replace or modify. For example, this one of the successful example is of alpha amylase from Bacillus subtilis, where acetylation with para-nitrophenyl acetate has been done, and it has resulted in increased thermostability above 70 degrees Celsius. So if you mutate this enzyme with para-nitrophenyl acetate, the alpha amylase will work above 70 degrees Celsius. Similarly, there is another successful example of rennet, which is used in cheese coagulation or cheese industry for cheese production. From mucor, it has been acylation has been performed using anhydride, and up to 2-fold increase in milk coagulation activity has been reported. And the fourth method is PCR based mutagenesis. It is generally a DNA amplification technique, you know, PCR. But PCR mutagenesis is based on the use of two oligonucleotides that hybridize to each one strand of target DNA. Exponential amplification of DNA region will result in the oligonucleotides which are produced, which contain the mutation. That is, the oligonucleotides which we have used during the repeated cycle of denaturation, annealing and polymerization, they will result in simple and efficient generation of mutants, because these oligonucleotides contain the desired mutation at one site or one place. This method is very rapid. Base substitution, insertion and deletion has been incorporated using this method. Few more techniques have been discovered recently. One is DNA shuffling, which is also known as molecular breeding. As the name indicates, you have to shuffle DNA, that is incorporation of recombination into a method for direct evolution of single genes. In this method, a population of mutant genes, large population in fact I will say, they are selected on the basis of their containing beneficial mutations. The genes are randomly fragmented. The fragments are combined with each other. It can be applied to sequences above 1 kilo base pair. The mutation rate is similar to error-prone PCR. Pool of unknown sequences can be tried, and removal of natural mutations by backcrossing can be accompanied. How we perform it? This is a parent sequence where we treat with DNase 1. We get random fragments. These fragments we will mix and we will anneal together, so different permutation and combination will be produced. These will be annealed and then primer extension will be done, so DNA is shuffled. So this is a kind of PCR without primers. PCR is done without primers. These are single-stranded DNA called as oligonucleotides or oligos for short. These are only of 8 oligonucleotide long octamers, and they consist of every possible combination of bases, which means there must be different combinations in the mixture. For example, we can generate 65,536 combination. Because every possible hexamer is present, these primers can bind to any section of DNA. These DNA fragments may contain low level of point mutation, as well as result of these base mispriming or misincorporation. So following removal of the template, the short fragments can prime one another based on the sequence homology and be recombined into full length genes by repeated thermocycling. So we can recombine them in DNA polymerase enzyme. Finally, these random primers are mixed, the template is removed, they can be reassembled, they can be amplified, we get positive clones or negative clones which can be tested. The resulting full-length genes may be further amplified by PCR and cloned into a vector for expression, followed by screening and selection of recombinants with desired. So these were the various methods. Towards the end, there are limitations. There are certain drawbacks of protein engineering or enzyme engineering. Although the potential of protein engineering is enormous, but inability to apply the technique to its fullest potential, there are number of factors responsible. Number one, 3D structure of most of the enzyme is not known. Okay, so when this 3D structure is not known, how you can use this data in computer-aided molecular modeling? So only few 750 enzymes is known, so it means you cannot carry out enzyme engineering on other enzymes. Lack of knowledge of exact interaction, that is hydrogen bonds, hydrophobic bond, electrostatic interaction made between enzyme and substrate at active site is not known. Which amino acid form part of active site is also not known. And what are their interaction? Which type of bonds are formed? And the third is lack of knowledge of processed factors involving in conferring stability to proteins is also not known. So these are some of the limitations of engineering. These are the references which I have used. And finally, thank you very much for your patience. If you have any questions or queries, you can raise it in the form through email to me, and I am ready to answer your queries. Thank you very much.